Oh, Kia came in late last night for an AC check. But we're not here just for an AC check on the Kia. Thanks for tuning in. I appreciate you tuning in to Making It Work. I'm Jimmy. If you're new and you're like, who's this old guy walking around with a flashlight on him in the dark? We're going to spend a day in the shop. We've been really busy this week, so I hope you've enjoyed the content so far. We'll put some clips in right here of what you can expect to see in today's episode of Day in the Shop. Kia Sportage G35 from yesterday. Sunshine! I know we can see that. We put a lot of effort in this channel into learning a thing or two, teaching a thing or two, and definitely having some fun. I can be a little goofy or silly. I got a lot of opinions like everybody else. So we try to make it enjoyable while we try to accomplish things at the same time, if that makes sense. That's my theory on how to do it anyway. I'm not going to trick you into buying things. I'm not going to try to make you think I'm a genius. I'm just a mechanic, and I film what I do at work. I hope it helps you out. Let's finish getting the shop opened up. Make a small note that it's really damp and humid, but it's only about 72, 73 degrees. Central Florida, that's not bad. We'll probably be about 90 today. For those of you who are interested in my weather reports, let's finish getting the shop open up and get started. Stay tuned. The back area, I gotta come out here and I gotta clear a few things out of the taco because tomorrow there'll be a new truck in that spot. Stay tuned for that. 2012 Nissan Maxima. I had to get some cleaning rags, some wipe towels, because I touched the steering wheel. And I don't know if that's dookie or what, but I know one thing. They got plenty of masks. And if you touch the steering wheel, it comes off on your hand, whatever sticky substance that might be. I mean, I don't know if they understand that cleanliness is not only next to godliness, but if you want to prevent yourself from getting sick, one way to do it is to clean stuff you touch. I don't understand. It's not here for any of that. 204,249 miles. They said it jerks when you're trying to drive. And they had another shop put spark plugs in and that didn't help. So they want to know what I think. And I can't even drive it until I spend 20 minutes cleaning the steering wheel. So we're going to do what we have to do. And then we're going to take it for a little drive, put the scanner on it, see if it's got codes or something. I mean, I'm going to have to just get rubber gloves to drive this car, I think, because I'll never get this wheel clean. I don't know what is on it. It's sticky, and it comes off on my hand, so. Gross! I think I'll put the scanner on it first just to see if there's any codes so I don't have to drive it. If necessary, I'll put some gloves on. Let's get the scanner. Oh, my goodness gracious. One on the love scale. 204,000 miles though, I don't know. Maybe they must be at least changing the oil. All right, I'm trying to get the V-Diag tool to do stuff. And it's kind of froze there. I don't know what's going on. Got this wheel a little clean, but I don't, you know. What do you suppose it is? Dead skin? I don't know. A little grossed out right now if you can't. Even the GoPro's grossed out. It turned itself off. I don't know how much of it recorded or not, but in any event, this thing's frozen, so I'm gonna force a reset and we'll see if there's any codes in any PCM or TCM, powertrain control module, transmission control module, engine control module, any of those control modules, and we'll go from there. And wish me luck. Wish me luck. Oh, I got approval on the AC compressor on the Kia. So once I take a look at this one, we'll be doing that. And then the Acura with the alternator from yesterday, they declined. They don't want to fix it. Kind of weird. We just put a very expensive transmission in about 2 months ago or a month ago. But they don't want to do the alternator yet. The strange thing too is the alternator is kind of charging. It's when you put the AC and the lights on and the wipers, then it doesn't charge enough. So it's, you know, working at half its normal capacity or something, if that makes sense. I'm not even going to update it. I'm going to go ahead and auto scan it and see what all the modules think. Uh-oh. No codes in any module. That means I have to drive it. I'm gonna have to get my rubber gloves and take this thing for a little drive, and we'll come back. We'll see if we can figure something out for this customer. 10 modules and it's taking a second. This is probably my second favorite scan tool, although this morning it's acting a little weird. Maybe those 4 updates I should have done. I'm not really sure, but the Phoenix Light 2, I'm gonna try to use a little bit today and tomorrow as well, just to see how it works without the subscription enabled. I don't think it'll be a problem, but what'll happen is if they have a new update for like a Ford, I won't be able to get that update till I pay for the updates. It'll still do what it used to do from everything I'm hearing, which is the case with most scan tools, but we'll find that out too. I'm gonna go drive this thing and we'll go over what I found. That's pretty funny. Infiniti, Nissan GTR, and Nissan updates. Maybe there's an issue with that. I brought up some transmission data, primary speed, secondary speed, engine speed, vehicle speed, and I'm gonna wipe this mirror off so I can see out of it real quick. All right. I'm amazed. I apologize. Some people might not think it's funny, but I'm just amazed. I don't know. It is what it is, I guess. I'm gonna try to drive it. I'm gonna film some of it if I can. I don't like to film and drive. Some of you might know that. I know there's a lot of channels that will video their driving and talk to the camera while they're driving. I don't like to do that. If I get a better camera mount, I don't have to hold the camera. Maybe it'd be better. But oh, I just heard a weird noise. I don't know if it was a puddle or something, but check tire pressure. I'm not going to go too far in case this thing's really doing something bad. I'm going to drive some laps around here and see if I can get it to misbehave. And then we'll come back. The only thing I can really feel on this car is some motor mount issues. And it does do like a little like transmission slip or hesitation kind of thing from the engine. It's kind of hard to decipher. Pretty slight. It just and then goes. So I'm going to just bring it back to the shop. It doesn't seem to run too bad. It feels like it's got a CVT in it, the way the transmission works. But I want to see if it's got a torn boot from a mass airflow to the engine kind of thing, or under a certain amount of load. Let's see, it just did it there. Good, good. So it could be a transmission slip. Could just be like a torn boot to the mass airflow sensor, which would explain no codes. Because if mass airflow sensor readings are weird, but they seem accurate to the computer, you won't get a code. So let's take a look around under the hood a little bit, and nothing pops out at me to worry about. And like I've said before, if you watch a lot of my videos, when the car's not sending a code, it's going to be very hard for a mechanic to find a problem that the computer doesn't see. So, but we will have us a look, because there are certain things that can happen that it won't set a code. It just thinks that's what happened. You know what I mean? The computer just goes, oh, okay, they must have let off the gas and hit the gas again really quick because the boot opened up and let unmetered air in, that kind of thing. Let's take a look. I don't want anyone to get sad about when I give people a hard time about being messy. I'm not criticizing them. I'm encouraging them to do better. That's all. It's just something I can't help myself from doing. That's why I got my hood shock tool. I knew it. Uh-oh, someone's already done a boot. Someone expected the same thing I was expecting. That's good and bad. It's good that the boot's not torn. It's bad that someone's been down that road trying to figure out what that little hesitation is. What I'm going to do now is, that was really, I really expected to go in there and find a torn boot. Someone's already done it. We'll shut it off. We'll go inside. We'll look and see if there's service bulletins or something about this hesitation problem. These Nissans are really bad for throttle bodies. I've had some that I cleaned the throttle body on. You couldn't get it to idle below 1,000 RPM afterwards. And it takes like 500 miles to relearn for some reason. I don't know why, but it does. This isn't going to be much use. I could look at some mass airflow data, though. A dirty mass airflow sensor could potentially cause this issue. Maybe we'll do that before I unplug it. Take a look at that mass airflow sensor. All right, now we're outside the car where it's probably a little safer. Verify there's no codes. I'm going to look in my mass airflow data, which should be around here somewheres. It might say inlet mass air. Maybe I missed it, but mass airflow sensor. Custom. Graph. Combine. All right, now what I want to do is, I wish I had wireless capability on the scanner. You guys might know that. Someone's already been messing with this. You can see there's marks from tools on there, but I'm going to jiggle the sensor and see if anything happens with this. I'm jiggling the connector. Sometimes you can just barely jiggle it. Sometimes it takes a more serious jiggle. But we'll try both. Moving wires around. See any problems right there. Let me get a little something to tap on it sharply, like the handle of a screwdriver, and see if I see any spikes. I don't see any problem with that. I'm guessing someone's already tried that too. I'm afraid to sell them anything based on it just goes and it goes 204,000 miles. You tell them it maybe needs a transmission. Maybe that's not how you do things. I think we're going to need to advise this customer to live with that little hesitation until it gets worse or until it sets a code. We'll know, we'll have a much better sense of direction once we get some kind of an idea which circuits to check. There is no service bulletins related to that. It does have a service bulletin for PO101 mass airflow sensor code with no drivability concerns. This is the opposite. We have drivability concerns and no codes. Let me let them know up front that this thing is not showing itself, and it's going to be pretty time consuming to drive it and test and check things and drive it and test. You know, it's, you get in the way, you can spend several hours. And I have a lot of work to do, so one way or another, we'll update you when we find out how much further we're going to go with this car, how much time they want to spend on it. We used our sweet new AC machine to rip the Freon from this clutches of this car. Now we're going to lift it up and we're going to do a belt tube. Rob looked at this yesterday. He used to work at Kia, for those of you who don't know. This is a 2014 Kia Sportage, and it's got 120,000 miles on it, and a love rating of 3. So let's get it up in the air and see if we can get that compressor off of there. Apparently the clutch doesn't work, but there's power going to it, so we don't know what, if there's anything else wrong with the system until we get that working. Bill and Rob messing with that Honda. Kid put all aftermarket clutch stuff and high performance stuff, and got the hot air intake system going, and he's got a high performance clutch in a bone stock engine. Can't get it to work right. It grinds going in reverse, and he wants to know if we could fix it. So yeah, we'll put all the stock clutch stuff back in it.
Not up to me, that's all I'm saying.
I feel kind of bad for the kid. He's a young guy. He just wants cool stuff. I understand that. I did the same thing when I was young. But the reason for a high performance clutch is because, like, you put a turbocharger and camshafts and get cylinder head work, and you got 350 horsepower in your four cylinder, and you need a better clutch because it'll slip. It's kind of odd. I don't know how you make, make that leap to putting a clutch in your car. Maybe I'm guessing the clutch went bad, so you thought a high performance clutch would be cool. Kind of makes sense that way, I guess. But they're real finicky and things have to match, and you can't use components from all different companies unless you know a lot about the engineering
and how to get it all to work. So we'll probably be able to figure it out, but it's going to be time consuming. We'll see what happens. I'll update you. Bill's working on that. I'm just doing this compressor.
I'm just being nosy, trying to figure out what the kids are up to today. This is an easy compressor. Refrigerant's already out of it. This hose is no good. Looks like it's collapsing. But that's because it's under a vacuum. When there's refrigerant in it, shouldn't do that, I hope. But I did look at it this morning, and the clutch never engages. So this is going to be a secondary problem. I wish I would have seen yesterday, but we'll do what we got to do to make it work, baby. No problem. There's some 12s for the lines, or are they 10s? 12s, and these are 12s, four of those. This has been changed already, too. Maybe someone put a salvage compressor, because it looks like it's been on there a while. Or they took it off for something else, like an oil pan gasket. You know what I should do? Stop flapping and start working. All right, electrical connector. This is a variable displacement electric clutch, so it has both. And they're real high failure items. If you guys watch a lot of my videos, you've probably seen me do four of these in the past 4 or 5 months. So it's pretty common failure. So in any event, let's get some ratchet wrenches and assorted sockets and stuff. Start popping these lines off. With the lines out of the way, it's easier to get to the top bolts. You can kind of see right here what I'm working with. Got the gear wrench quarter drive. Swivelly head ratchet. See if it can do it. Man, that was pretty tight. Gear wrench socket, gear wrench ratchet. All the stuff a professional should never use. I got a lot of ideas for some new videos. So you guys ought to stay tuned for those. I've seen a lot of videos that touched on some subjects like running a shop and how much mechanics should make and expectations for mechanics and versus what they get paid and all that kind of stuff. And like just yesterday, I was watching a video where someone was saying that the average mechanic nowadays makes $23 an hour, and I hope that's not true. I was making $23 an hour when I started here in 2007. So, and that was low. They started me $2 lower, like a probationary thing, because they weren't sure if I was being honest about my capability. But in reality, it was a way for them to just make a little more money for 90 days. And after 90 days, they gave me $2 more. So I was making $25 an hour in 2007. So I hope if you're a good mechanic and you're watching my videos, you're not working that cheap. If a shop charges $150 an hour, you should be in the 30s somewhere. If you're very competent in doing drivability and things like that. But anyway, the lines are off. I'll take this belt off of here, and those are 10s. And an extension, and then we can get to the belt tensioner easier.
My son-in-law Michael texted me, "Still coming up to get the truck tonight?" I said, "Yeah." I'm like, especially if it's going to create some controversy, it's even more fun.
17 millimeter on the belt tensioner. And we are going to be replacing this belt. So, I'm looking at it. It comes down to this pulley, up to the alternator, and over to the tensioner that way. So if we remember those two things, we should be good to go. Uh-oh, I took the belt off for nothing, I think, because it was like that. But I think this belt, I had them order for my truck. I gotta go check the paperwork. I don't think I've gotten it yet. So I'm not sure if I was supposed to take that belt off. Not that it's hard. We make it work no matter what, so no big deal. Once the hoses are out of the way, you can get to these top two bolts much easier.
Where you at? I broke the bolts loose with the hand ratchet. I'm gonna spin them out with power tools. I'm no animal, I'm not a caveman. Listen, about Well, let's hope it happens then, what do you say?
It didn't want to go. Maybe it's twins, that's the problem.
No, it's a boy.
Old O-rings, new O-rings. You see a problem? I get a little nervous when I get a compressor and they give you the wrong size O-rings. Those will work a little better.
Got a whole kit.
Four of those. And I can hook up the hoses. You can't over tighten these. Now, whenever they have the case circular gasketed, then you have to be careful because you can't over tighten one bolt more than the others a lot and cause a distortion and make them leak. Pretty rare, but it's possible. Just something to keep in mind when you're snugging her up. A little bit of refrigerant oil on the O-rings as always.
There's a little guide pin in there. I hope it's in the right place and it's not different for this compressor.
Just needed two hands.
I'm gonna turn this compressor hub,
cycle some of the oil out of it so
it doesn't click on and try to pump a bunch of oil right off the bat. That's what hurts the seals, hurts the compressor potentially. Half the time it probably won't hurt anything, but it's a risk if you don't do this. I'm gonna tighten up this little splash seal once I get done with this. I'm even gonna throw that lower cover on. I'm feeling a little cocky. I trust Rob's diagnosis work. Plus this morning I put a AC clutch test relay in and forced it on and nothing happened. So that way I know that if the thermistor in the evaporator goes bad, that will stop it from turning the compressor on. If the high pressure switch is bad, it will stop it from turning the compressor on. But if the relay is activated, that means the ECM is happy with everything else and it goes directly to the compressor. And since we did that and nothing happened, I know either the compressor is bad, there's a small chance of wire, but like I said, Rob worked at Kia for like 4 years and he got to be the team leader there and all that kind of stuff. He knows Kias inside and out. He knows a lot of cars, but especially Kias and Hyundais. To get this thing vacuuming, Rob started doing I got to do a muffler in this Corolla. Now, Rob's basically almost got it all off ready. It's really easy, just two bolts and two rubber hangers, but let's go over there and help him out. Look, Rob's having the Midas touch.
Oh, she's causing trouble.
That's it, I'm telling Grandma.
Look at that cool camo tool. He calls it the camel toe tool. I just call it camo tool.
No gas leaks, we're good to go. It's gonna be tricky here. Don't worry, my face is not in the way. Something is about to happen. Got it!
Spring, right?
That is the nicest exhaust installation ever. Now we gotta start it up, make sure it ain't leaking. We're trying to save the pipe in front because, you know, it's always a money situation. So we'll see what we can do for that gasket I put. We had a stack of gaskets and we found one that fits with the other piece being slightly rusty. That's a lot better than the one you're supposed to use, which is this one. So just gotta make sure it's not leaking and we're good with this car. The other ones, done vacuuming, we're putting refrigerant in it. We'll go look at that one too. Nice. Rob's pulling it around. We should have 1.1 pounds of refrigerante in here. I do not wish to take a snapshot. I'm good to go. I'm gonna fire this thing up and see how the pressures look.
And then the final thing will be to tell the machine it's okay to pull refrigerant out of the hoses, but we want to close these valves before we do that, which means I'm going to run it first. Oh, something's happening. I saw the pressure drop on the low side. All right. Perfect. That's the official performance test. I'm gonna say it's already about 50 degrees or less and it's dropping. You actually, a lot of these Asian cars, I mean most newer cars actually, since they went to 134A, it seems like when they're working correctly, it'll actually have a little bite to it where it's uncomfortable to keep your hand right in front of it like that. Especially for a Florida guy. This one's done, I'm gonna finalize it, and customer's anxious to get this car back too, so we'll see what else is next. Yeah, I did nothing. This is the old G35 from yesterday, if you didn't see yesterday's video. I had some big strong men help me push it in because I can't do it by myself, it's heavy. We're trying to find out why the main fuse is blowing in the fuse box, and I already found it, full disclosure. I just want to show you guys. I mean, it's got oil leaks and things you'd expect on a high mileage vehicle. Got aftermarket exhaust and stuff, took cats out, so it's fast. But they put a new fuse assembly on the battery and it blew again, so they brought it in here and I'll show you why. Do, do, do. See that? Does that show up? That bolt there, when you crank the engine, it will short. It will short against the starter case, and that's not good. So we're gonna get that bolt out of there, and they're getting me another fuse panel assembly, which the battery terminal's a fuse, got a fuse on it. You can see where the bolt's sticking out in the bottom there. I'll have to make a short about it once these guys stop all the caveman stuff. I was hoping I'd get it out of there with the magnet, but it's jammed in there pretty good. I have to get my screwdriver, see if we can do it that way. Don't put that away yet. There's no power to it because that main fuse is blown. Plus this lug only activates when you crank it. So what'll happen is they'll be able to put the fuse in, and then the first time they crank it, it'll blow. So I gotta try to get this out of here. Sorry if I made you dizzy. Let's see. Got it. Little rascal causing all that trouble. All that trouble. Alright, I'm gonna take the ground off here so we're not live, and then we'll start taking this up. Just some connectors here, and then these two bolts, I believe, and should come out of there. Couple of these, couple of those. I don't know if this part's here yet. We got to get it still, but shouldn't blow again now that we got the shorts fixed. That's the good news. Yeah. Little contraption, huh? That's where it's blown. Right there. All right, we got new stuff. New good days. Plugged in. Now this can't go under here. Some people might say that this goes underneath, but it's got to be fused anyway, and it does fit right in there, so that's where it's going. That's the bottom line. You got some work to do though.
What?
Huh?
Hey, nothing exploded. That's a good sign. No more bolts melted to the starter case, and everything's going to be like brand new. Now, when we made the jumper before, it would crank and not start, but all these wires down here weren't getting power because that fuse was blowing. It powers up that side, so we should be good to go. This is a lighter fuse for the other connector, and the hazards and stuff worked, so I'm guessing that's what that went to.
Perfect.
Okay, now it goes to a no start.
The key light's staying on. I wonder if some kind of security thing reset. Try locking and unlocking the door. See if that helps.
You crazy little son of a gun. See, there's no key fob, but we have this. This is the key that does the door that you take out of the key fob. And this is the key that works the ignition. But there's no key fob around. We have immobilizer keychain. So, lock mode P1610. That's the engine. Transmission's just gonna say manual mode switch, airbag codes, they won't stop from starting. BCM. We got tire pressure codes. Okay. I'm gonna try clearing these codes. I've already saved the report so I can send it. I'm gonna clear these codes out of these four modules. We'll try to start it again. This aftermarket alarm light, it's not supposed to be there. And the immobilizer light right there is not supposed to be on. It's supposed to go out after a couple seconds. It'll do a bulb check and turn off. So I think we need his key fob, whatever this plugs into, and the car should start. We're not seeing any blown fuses or anything like that, so. I'm gonna clear the codes and try that though. Right now, intelligent key. Let's try to turn the key off, crank it up again, see what happens. Yeah, nothing. Let's try it again. Lock mode, P1610, so. I have to let the customer know we need his key fob. And since this fuse component has been changed by the customer himself, and it happened again, so he must know that he needs something like that, you would think. But I know we'll contact him and find out, figure it out. You are terrific. Customer's bringing a key fob for this one. That one, we smell a little something funny, but that little jerk problem, she doesn't really want to get too crazy. We'll see what happens with that. And I'm gonna head out, go trade my truck in and come back with a new truck, and that'll be in tomorrow's video. So I'm leaving early today before we're closed up. That's rare. So thanks for watching. Torque the like button before you head out. Hope you enjoyed today's video. Subscribe if you're new. Check out the Amazon store. I got a what else. Hope I see you in the next video, because you're awesome.